I felt like I was such a burden. I think that's the key word. I felt like a burden.
Jeg har ikke lyst til å leve lenger.
I don't know why I'm here. What's the point?
I didn't feel like I had a place in the world anymore.
If no one can help me, okay, I knew there and then I was going to commit suicide.
Jeg kunne ikke se for meg hvordan jeg skulle dø. Men jeg kunne se for meg at jeg ikke fantes mer.
I was like, this can't be it. Like, life can't be this meaningless.
Dødsønsken blir egentlig bare høyere. Jeg hadde mer og mer lyst til bare å forsvinne etter hvert.
I didn't expect to survive that period of time.
Jeg prøvde å ta livet mitt to ganger.
Og der alligevel ikke noen der vil savne meg på noen måte, hvis jeg alligevel bare forsvinner.
Jeg ønsket virkelig å ta livet av meg, fordi at da trodde jeg at alt ble så mye, mye bedre for de som var rundt meg.
We were losing people to drugs and overdoses. We were losing people to suicide.
My life's toughest challenge was losing my 27-year-old son in suicide.
My childhood friend Jonas took his life.
He had committed suicide. It was like the biggest fucking shock ever, right?
Og miste min bror, som valgte å ta selvmord.
My partner, father to my little girl, he decided to commit suicide.
I found myself thinking about suicide a lot, and that was hard, man. That was really hard, because of all the people that I know is happening to me.
I had extreme suicidal thoughts during my teenage years.
Some people in this world are born to be happy, more happy than others. I am not one of them. I was born to be sad, and I was born to be alone and afraid.
Everyone go through this type of period in their life one time or another, and it's pretty human.
Suicide is a huge global issue. We have one person every 40 seconds dying by suicide. That's incredibly much, 800,000 every year.
It's about not being able to live because you don't have that energy to feel. To feel joy, to feel fine, to just feel. It's very sort of head, very emotionless. And that's not a great place for people to be.
I was nothing. I was a shell of a person without feelings, thoughts, goals, dreams. I had nothing. I was just empty.
I couldn't see myself on the mirror. I was so scared to see me because my eyes looked so... I was gone. My soul was gone.
I didn't care, actually, at that point. I really didn't care.
And I remember taking the pills and falling asleep and feeling like the drugs taking part in my body. And I just thought, oh, peace. And it was so nice to feel that feeling of peace and being like, oh, I can sleep now.
Suicide kills 200 children a year in the UK. It's the biggest killer. And it's the biggest killer in Norway as well, actually, of people between 10 and 24. I mean, and we don't talk about it. That's the problem. It's kind of like a secret that we choose not to talk about.
And when you're living in your own thoughts, the critical voice is very loud. And that voice led me to feel like I wasn't good enough, to feel like I was inadequate, to feel like I didn't have much to offer in this world.
The way you think is how you interpret the world. How you interpret the world becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy. And they are very primed to notice failure. And they will blame themselves for the failure.
Jeg synes jo aldri at jeg var god nok og flink nok som far.
I felt not being capable of a good mom. I could barely take care of my own self.
For jeg hadde fryktelig dårlig samvittighet når jeg ikke kunne delta i ting. Med å bare være meg selv. Så da fant jeg ut at da skulle jeg gjøre det slutt. Altså, det var ikke verdt noe.
So within depression, individuals will have particular cognitive errors, so information processing errors, that lead them to a negative way of interpreting an event. So every human being does it, but there's a characteristic that happens that will take you down the depressive line that stops you being able to talk yourself back. So, for instance, cracking one would be mind reading. I will assume I know what you think about me, but you bet your bottom dollar it won't be positive. Yeah? Or let's think of another one. There's one called mental filter. I will always interpret everything as negative.
I've always been a thinker, so my thoughts were primarily very negative and very hard, very self-doubting.
Ja, men du prøver jo bare å gjøre inntrykk, og du prøver å være vellykket. Så, men du jo ikke det. Du jo helt ubrukbar. Altså, hva det du holder på med?
I saw myself as not worthy at all of attention or friendship.
I still hate myself. I still think I'm fat. I still don't think I'm worthy or I deserve what I need to get in life.
I'm not smart, I'm not funny, I'm not pretty, I'm not anything.
I tried to believe my family and my boyfriend when they said, like, you are a great person and we love you very much and we need you and we want you in this world. I just felt like they were saying that to be nice because I didn't love myself anymore, and how could someone else love me?
When you have no self-worth, then the hardest fight of your life is just a waste of time.
I think most people who are depressed will have had suicidal thoughts at some point. Now, whether they can, I think most of us have thoughts where we think, is this really worth it? Is this what life really is?
And you're not worth anything, and you're not valuable, and there's no hope for the future, and you know, all this stuff. And everyone is better off without me.
Livet var ikke noe for meg, da. Det liksom, jeg får det ikke til å funke uansett. At jeg hører ikke til hva det jeg følte på jorda, liksom. At det var en feil, og at jeg ble født, på en måte.
I thought I was strong because I was a boxer, and I was doing things. People wanted to look like me, be like me, and then all of a sudden you're like, fuck, I don't know who I am anymore in this space.
It was so painful, like the physical pain, it was immense. Like I couldn't breathe, and I had such a pain in my chest and in my heart. And I remember thinking the only way this pain is gonna go away is if I end it.
I think I'm going through suicidal thoughts. And I was like, shit. And you just break down. And you're like, whoa.
I think that's actually perfectly normal for when you have really tricky periods in your life. The difference is the quality of that and how all-consuming it becomes. And then when there's a, I'd say, fixation, or people start sliding towards planning, yeah? And then sliding towards little trials of the plan. And before you know it, you're acting on it.
I was in a tunnel and the highway, and I remember that I was so close to driving into the wall.
I think I just got a suicide note from Thomas. Is this a prank?
Jack noticed the phone ringing, and it was our daughter who rang because they had found Daniel, who had taken his own life.
And then the police called and said, please park the car. So we went in there. It was a gas station, and in the car, they told us that we couldn't save him. We couldn't. He died.
Daniel's dad just said, we need to go. We went straight out of the hall into a taxi. And he said, Daniel's dead, Daniel's dead.
And it was just that overwhelming sorrow, panic.
It felt like it was just a massive blackness that came over me.
I just remember there was a line in the toilet, and I just said, please let us in.
This grief has dropped a bomb in my life. Everything I've predicted in my life has gone. So it's a bit like an existential crisis. People they work really, really hard to make their lives predictable and regular and work hard to anticipate. So it's personal construct psychology, where we will all have our own sort of template that we lay over the world, because what human beings can't cope with is something that has no routine and is unpredictable.
I didn't know he was suicidal. I didn't know. I couldn't understand how could he do that, but he just put the shotgun in his head and he shot himself.
I need to just get out of my head. Why do you need to get out of your head? Because I can't cope with what else is there.
I was in shock. I just wanted to end my life. It was too much. It was too heavy burden to carry.
That's that existential crisis. If it's going to be something that throws my life into disarray, then I'm going to struggle. Another one might be, quite a common one that's an invisible one, is only bad things happen to bad people. This concept that life is fair, whereas actually life is random. So people work really hard to try and make sense of something that has no sense. Yeah, so the death of a child would potentially fall into that category, wouldn't it? I can't find a way to understand this. Yeah, because it is incomprehensible. So how do you come to accept something that you can't understand?
Was it that bad? Was it really that bad? Yes, it must have been. And so, but was there then something that I didn't know about? Did he have some other problems that he hadn't told me about that were secrets? Or, and so it adds to the sort of general just chaos of not understanding, of not knowing, of feeling useless, feeling really quite useless as a mom.
What kind of a mom let your son die?
Even though I'm not going to be in this world anymore with the people who love me, I felt like I was doing them a favor because I wasn't myself anymore, and I felt like they had no reason to love me anymore. They had no reason to want to be with me. And if I just disappeared from the world, it would be better for me. It would be better for them.
That is the worst lie. We are not better out without Thomas. And I hope that they will find that we're not. We're not just moving on and having a better life. We're carrying this inside, all of us.
If I did something stupid, not only would it affect me, I'll be gone. I'll be dead. I'm done, right? But it will leave my family in darkness.
When we have people phone our crisis team, one of the most important questions I think in that interchange, that interaction, is how did you decide to phone me? What was it that made you phone me? And then the person will tell you what their reasons for living are.
I've really been close to suicide several times, but my kids always kept me from it. Just the thought of my kids, of leaving them alone, basically. Yeah.
Sist liksom som jeg husker at jeg tenkte på, var mamma. Og så kjente jeg at jeg angret meg et sekund.
My job was to stay alive and make sure that my little girl was okay.
Short time after he died, I saw a picture like of a big black hole. And I saw it next to me and I thought, I know, it looks so tempting just to jump in there and just wallow in my own sorrow and just never get out. And I know it's gonna be warm in the beginning. But then I just kept looking at it. It's gonna be really cold after a little while.
It's really easy to do it. I can do it anytime, but I don't have to.
I've got two friends here in Norway from England who went through the same period. And whenever we get together, we have to have a drink and say, did we really expect to be here now? And I didn't.
Start with a plan and look out in your municipality. What resources do you have? What have you done so far? And what does science say that you need to work on?
But I think the most important part of the plan is that you're not doing this on your own. So what is the help you are going to need?
My doctor told me, like, we want to help you, of course. And they told me this is depression. And this is not you. This is not the real Alexandra. The real Alexandra is still in there. And we have to help her get back out and make you feel better.
It was time for me to heal.
Maybe there's a way out of this. Maybe I can get back to the person I used to be.
A lot of mental health problems are counterintuitive in comparison to physical health problems. So in physical health problems, if I break my leg, I rest and I don't use my leg magically heals. And when it's better, I can use it. And I might need a bit of rehab, a bit of physio, but I don't do anything until it's better. That's completely the opposite in mental health. Mental health, if you don't do anything till you feel better, you will never feel better.
Istedet for å ringe psykologen min 30 ganger med å tro at jeg skulle ta livet mitt, så plutselig sto jeg i en telefonnummer til Fontenehuset.
Så sa han at jeg vet om noen som kan hjelpe deg, og det et hjem for selvmordsforebygging.
Det går et par måneder, og jeg begynner å få meg venner der. Jeg begynner å få god kontakt med folk. Jeg kjenner at jeg har en godt med å stå opp om morgenen. Jeg begynner å vise mye engasjement. Jeg begynner å se at jeg kan få til ting.
I was at a silent retreat for 10 days, meditating 12 hours a day. And the first 4 days were hell. At the end of the retreat, on the 9th day, I didn't have a single thought. I was very calm, I was very peaceful. And the moment that I broke the silence, I remember crying a lot because it was the most beautiful thing that I ever done to be silent and to be with myself.
Working on myself 24/7.
And then I was like, wow, I'm changing. I'm coming out of this darkness.
You need to put in the work and you need to do it for yourself. And if anything, if not for you, then do it for me.
I cannot change the fact that he's dead. But I have to start looking at what can I do something about.
Suicide can be extremely meaningless, but if you contribute and do something with your sorrow and try to help others, it becomes a little less meaningless.
When you wake up with a why, you know, it's like, okay, this is my goal. I want to try to help the services be so good that less people commit suicide.
Maybe this book can help other people to understand what it's like, and also for people who are thinking about it to understand how terrible this is.
Det har hjulpet meg veldig å høre andre sine historier, og at jeg har klart å se et håp da på min situasjon.
It isn't hopeless when somebody is having thoughts of taking their own lives, because there are ways that they can be helped and supported. I'm not saying we can save everybody, but we can certainly support and help a lot of them.
So I guess that's when I actually more accepted he's dead. I can't save him, but maybe I can save someone else.
Every single one of us has the potential to be a life savior.
The guaranteed way to save somebody's life is to just say, how are you? Now in England, if you say, how are you? Oh, I'm fine. So you do the twice, how are you? How are you? I'm fine. No, I mean, how are you? And you let somebody actually tell you what's going on. Once you've made that connection, you can do something to help.
It was just that one friend that messaged me the next day saying, how are you? And for that one text, I remember I would be forever indebted to her because it made me feel like I wasn't so alone.
You may be the first person who's actually courageous enough to talk about it. And if you're courageous about it, then possibility is that the other person will open up.
The more people who just open up and tell, I've been hospitalized, I've been struggling, the better it is. So I think being honest about it and using yourself as an example that it's possible to get well or get back or whatever is a way to reduce stigma.
One of the biggest mistakes I made was not speak about what I was going through. And that made it hard because the internal dialogue I had with myself wasn't healthy.
Jeg satt og tenkte at det var ingen som brydde seg, og folk ville synes det var digg hvis jeg døde, for da slapp de å bekymre seg for meg. Men det skal jeg love deg er ikke sant. Det er depresjon som snakker til deg. Det er ikke virkelighet i noen av de depresjonstankene som man har.
When you are in that state that you wanna commit suicide, it's like a virus taking over your brain. You are not you. That your soul is not there. You are not you.
Så inkluder mennesker, foreldre, besteforeldre, søsken, venner. Bare inkluder andre mennesker og tørre å snakke om det. Ikke holde for deg selv.
You are not alone, even though you feel this way.
Actually, like 300 million people around the world are affected by depression as we speak.
Det er helt normalt å ha menneskelige følelser, og at følelser går opp og ned.
Asking for help is something everyone that struggled with asking need to practice.
You can be a fighter and you can be as and kind of show yourself as strong and immortal as you want to, but being a true fighter is about showing vulnerability.
You have to get help. And that's for you. And you are worth it, even though you don't feel like you are right now.
It's actually recognizing there are positive and negative elements in everything. So I got up this morning. Yeah, that was an achievement. I'd like to have been able to do more, but I got up this morning and that was an achievement. So it's a both and. I'm recognizing that I want to do more than this, but I'm also recognizing I did it.
Celebrate the little things, because if you feel like you don't want to live the life you're having right now, just getting out of bed is a big accomplishment.
Man kan ikke hoppe fra 10 meteren med en gang, man må starte på 1 meteren. Og så kjenner man at, å, jeg klarer å hoppe fra 1 meteren, og så kan man ta 2 meteren.
You don't have to think about anything else. You don't have to plan your future. You don't have to worry about what you did yesterday or how your life has been up until this point. Just get through this one step and keep going.
Creating goals. Write small goals, write big goals. Take each calendar month to do something different. Because the brain loves doing different things. It needs a stimulus. It needs a stimulus. It needs to do something out of your comfort zone.
You know, comfort is poison. At one point, you have to leave it and you have to find new grounds to stand on.
It's not easy. And it's not a straight path. And days will come that may feel unbearable. But you can do it.
You got up this morning. You cleaned your kitchen. You did something good. You are a good person.
I wish so much that you would see how precious you are. And that you don't have to be perfect.
Choose to love yourself first, because self-love is the best ever gift you can give yourself.
Every time I'm on a plane, they say, please put on your own mask first before putting on others. And you need that oxygen yourself, or else you will be giving to people out of need and not out of abundance. And that is going to save so many of your relationships.
Remember to say good stuff to yourself, that you're doing the best you can.
Just say nice things to yourself, not the lies that you hear in your head. Because there are a lot of voices in our head that can make us think that this is the real truth. And we don't want that. We don't want to lose one more to suicide.
You are enough. You're amazing. You're strong.